Hi and welcome to Rockin' the Planet. I'm Shane, I'm so glad you could join me here just to help celebrate all that's great about New Zealand music. This week we go completely country. I'm joined by two of New Zealand's award-winning international country music artists, Mr. Peter Colton and Kevin Greaves. And here they are, Mr. Peter Colton. Peter,
nice
so glad to have you here, mate. Long time getting here.
Oh yeah.
And of course, we all know Mr. Kevin Greaves. Why do I talk like that when I speak about you? Because he's got that voice. Yeah, anyways, great to have you guys here.
Great
welcome
to be here,
to Rockin' the Planet.
Yeah.
I'm going to talk, please, Peter Colton, now, you're over here, been here for a while, back from overseas.
Yep, I got back in 2014, and from 23 years in Germany. So.
Yeah, 23 years in Germany.
Based in Europe, yeah.
Yeah, the war's over.
Yeah, but you know, if you're looking for the best audience in the world, they are, you know. So
no, they
great,
are.
It's a great place to play music.
Yeah, it is. I did the same myself.
Yeah.
Many years before you, but Germany. It's a long way to Germany. Now, why would you, from New Zealand? You're in New Zealand.
Yeah. Born in Gisborne.
Yeah, Gisborne. Yep. And you leave these shores and you take country music to Germany.
Well, I first went to Australia. I was in Australia for about 11 years. Yep. We had a big country bar in the 80s in Melbourne. This is 77. And I got involved in the first big country music festival, the biggest one at that time in Australia. It was the Wandong Country Music Festival, just on the outskirts of Melbourne. I remember doing a gig there one Sunday afternoon with 25,000 people with Midge Mars, and just the two of us went out there
and
brained him. So that was a big thrill. We had a big show we put together called the Vic State Opry, which was a country music rockabilly blues review, using a lot of the front men from the best of those genres in Melbourne. And then became a point where I just felt I wanted to go somewhere a bit further on.
Yeah.
And of course, I had a friend in Madrid, and he'd been at me for many years to come across. So I started out. Went down the winter, over the northern winter, ended up in Tenerife on the Canary Islands for 7 months playing there, and getting to know people, you know, and that sort of thing. Then I went from there to England, and I spent 9 months in England working in England, mainly in the northern part around the clubs. My modus operandi has always been the songs, great songs, and not so much, but country music, of course, had all the great songs. There was a lot of great songs still being written in country music, contemporary stuff with Chris Christopherson and stuff.
Yeah, we all love Chris.
Yeah, well, you know, all those guys. Gordon Lightfoot did some of his stuff as well. I mean, Jim Croce, those singer-songwriter guys, John Prine, writing great songs. So there was good things to sing. And even the pop stuff, of course, in the 70s was good. But then the 80s, it sort of got, starting to lose the way, There's still great music being made and has been all the time, along.
Of course,
James Taylor was always putting an album out. Jimmy Buffett's putting albums out. Bonnie Raitt's been putting albums out, but don't get played. That's it. The music's always been there, that genre and that standard, but the radio stations didn't.
Now, if I can,
and of course, country music's been the biggest country music in America for the last 20 years.
Yeah. Now, Germany, you chose Germany out of all the places. You settled there and you stayed there for 23 years, was it?
23 years.
23 years. Now, taking country music to Germany, it doesn't seem to me like, would there be a great country music thing going on there?
Well, yes, there's a room for just about all music in Germany. The Germans, as I said, are probably the best music audience in the world. But if you put, listen, you come from here, you get a lot back from a German audience.
Yeah.
You really do. I mean, and you get, there's more respect for artists over there. You never get the things you get here sometimes where you're going to a room and they got the television on and they leave it on while you're performing. That sort of stuff would never happen in Germany. They just got more respect for artists over there, and that's always nice. And the people you work for treat you well. You're well paid. You'll roll up a gig sometime, maybe just doing a bar gig. You roll up and the guy who runs the bar will say, you know, can I help you with the gear? You know, want a drink, want something to eat? You know, can I help? It's like that. That's different, of course, in England too. You know. Well, that was the other thing about Germany too. After many years playing like all sorts of gigs, like big gigs and all sorts of places, 23 years I didn't see one fight in a pub or in a venue.
That's nice, eh?
In 23 years. Yeah. And that's just nice. It's a more civilized.
But you're a big guy, you know.
I'm just playing them, you know. You're playing them, you see a fight break out. You know? It happened here, it happened in Australia, and it happens in England, but not in Germany.
Now, you, Kevin, have you been to, did you go to Europe at all?
I did. You did? Yeah.
Only just on tour. I got to tour Europe with Carl Perkins.
We started off in Scotland.
And we went to this place. It was a Butlins camp, right?
There was 9,000 people there for the whole weekend
for a country music festival. We arrived and there's like, everybody's dressed up like cowboys and Indians. And we arrive in this big limo with Carl and this, and he's like, oh, it's a fancy dress thing, you know. But no, that's just how they do it at these country music festivals over there. They dress up like cowboys and Indians. It's like, they had the sick guns and the whole thing.
There's a lot of, they come out of the closet, eh? I'm frustrated. I want to be Roy Rogers. Gene Autry, you know.
They've got these replica guns that are actually got blanks and stuff in them. They fire them off and it's about bloody deaf and you don't know.
Well, the last thing the band had to play each night was the American Trilogy, and they walked in with the Confederate flag and the U.S. flag and they walked in and had this big and they did this big folding ceremony, and once it, and it came to the crescendo of the, you know, the trilogy, and they all pulled their guns together, and it, oh, try not to.
It's insane.
So, did you ever go over to Europe apart from Scotland and so on, and Europe?
I did two trips over there. I did through England, Wales, and I've never been to Ireland. Unfortunately, I'd like to go there.
You'll love it.
My dad's parents were from there, but I've never got to go there. So I did through Germany, Austria, Italy, France. When I went to Monte Carlo, that's when I found out how many rich people there are in this world.
Anyway, from then on, you made your mind up to go to Nashville and live anyway, didn't you?
Well, yeah, I was living in Nashville when I went over there, you know, and so. They were just some trips that I got to do while I was there. So, you know, I was there for 15 years and it was, it was an experience. And started off playing in bars when you got $20 plus tips.
Well, the American way is the tipping.
You know, there was no cover charge to get in. So over here you might pay a cover charge to get into a club and see the band. Over there, you know, they come around with a tip jar and you put a couple of dollars in here and there, you know. But because there's like... Well, even more now, but at that time there was probably 12 or 15 different bars, honky-tonks they call them, playing there, and you could go from one to the other. It's huge now. It's like, it's probably 30 or so of the honky-tonks, and people like Alan Jackson have just opened a bar there, and Blake Shelton's just opening one, and that sort of thing.
It's about time we started doing that here, don't you think, Pete?
Well, yeah, it'll be good. But I mean, I've been shocked. I only moved to Auckland last year. How little music there was going on around this town. You know, live music. Yeah. You know, you go out to try and find it. Quite often in this town, it's not that easy. We do a lot more work out on the road than we do in Auckland itself.
You go to Sydney now. Sydney's absolutely there's nothing. There's no live music.
Well, it's the same. You were down in Napier last week. You were down in Hawke's Bay. So was I. Well, I was there. I had Friday night off, so I had a wander around Napier. Just to see if there's any live music on or anything going on at all. And basically, I went by the cabana. There was something going on. Yeah. It looked like there was a bunch of big women were going in there. But I thought it must have been a Jenny Craig Centre or something, meeting or something like that going on. Yeah. But there wasn't much music going on, but nothing. And then I went down the port, and there was about five or six restaurants down the old port, the old fishing port there. Just a bunch of people shoving food in their faces with no music.
And without getting too political, I'm trying to get a bunch of guys together to lobby the government. I've already done it once, but again, to have, because you go overseas and you see these big acts and bands and the RSAs and RSLs and whatever, and you think, how can they afford that? It's because of those gaming machines. But here in New Zealand, clubs can't use the gaming machines to help bolster their budget. You know, well, but they only allow so many, but they can't use it. They spend all this money on the arts thing and get New Zealand artists up to a certain point. Now they want to be a professional artist, and then they go out and there's no work.
There's no work.
A lot of the kids you see today, you know, they just sing. they don't actually entertain and all that. But that all comes down to experience. So they're not getting the experience. I mean, when I started out in Wellington, for instance, I first fished up in Christchurch. I started out in Christchurch, but it was the folk thing. And so I was playing coffee bars and stuff, and you're sitting there with a room full of say 60 people, just you and a guitar. Sometimes not even a PA, but people would shut up and listen in those days too. Yeah. And so consequently, you could talk to them and you could try different things out. And you got to learn how to do that thing. The kids today expected to come out of their garage fully blown, you know? Yeah. You know what I mean? And it's unreasonable for them, you know? I think, and it's real sad. I saw some good country acts down in Gore, for instance, when I went to the awards down there. And it's some good, and I'm thinking, where can they play? The only place they can play is like RSLs and working men's clubs to people 50 or more, you know? They can't play to their peers. Because none of the young kids come out for that type of music because they don't hear it, because the radio stations don't play it and the television stations don't play any of it either. So it's really sad for them. The only thing they've got for them is to head off overseas, kids, because that's about all they can do. Yeah.
We were talking earlier about your trip to Germany and everything else. Now, you were very fortunate there. You appeared on TV and various other things. And I think it's about time we had one of those great songs. Yeah. This is an appearance you... did on German TV.
Yeah.
I love it myself, and it's country music all the way, the hat, the gear, and you're out there doing it, and it just shows you the magic. Kiwis are doing it all over the world, and this one is no exception. Here's Peter Colton with Who Drove the Mystery Train.
Who drove the mystery train, screaming out of Memphis in the pouring rain? I saw it written on a water tank. Was it Jimmy Rogers or was it Hank? So I asked Willie, and he said Hank Snow. Waylon said it was Billy Joe. Both said the fireman was a long-legged girl, but rumor has it was Merle. Buck Gowan said, well, left you for Zell, but she was gone so fast it was hard to tell. Could have been the band of the Rolling Stones, maybe even George or Casey Jones. Mystery train, screaming out of Memphis in the pouring rain. I saw it written on a water tank. Was it Jimmy Rogers or was it Hank? Steve Goodman said I was by the track, and I'm pretty sure it was Lonnie Mack. John Hyatt said it's plain to me, I figured on John Fogerty. Johnny Cass said, you're all talking silly. The hand on the throttle was Boxcar Willie. Lucinda Williams said, boys, just wait. Don't you know it was Bonnie Raitt? Who drove the mystery train? Screaming out of Memphis in the pouring rain. I saw it written on a water tank. Was it Jimmy Rogers or was it Hank?
Who drove the mystery train?
Well, Peter Colton, wasn't that brilliant? New York City.
Peter, that song you were saying was written by an Australian?
Yeah, a guy named Kenny Joe Blake writes fantastic country songs. He's hasn't been really recognised in Australia, but we like looking for good songwriters, and he's one of the best I've come across. And he just writes great songs, and they haven't recognised him. And it's really sad because that song was nominated by the Texas Grammy Award as Song of the Year. On the Grammy Awards that year, we had that six. I think they put in about six categories the CD.
Great song.
Yeah, great song. You know, they're all great songs.
I mean, I would never have guessed it being Australia. It's so authentic. It's real Nashville.
Oh yeah.
I take my hat off to them a little bit because I was just over in Tamworth this year for the awards and stuff, and they Australia have their own country music thing, and the guys today are still writing those what they call bush ballads. They have Australian lyric content, but they've got more of a Nashville sound and feel to it. You know, they've so it's brought it sort of up to date. So the Australian country music is alive and well.
The Australians support the country music.
I agree.
It's only the older crowd we're getting. We're not getting younger people because they're not seeing it on. Again, I said before, I keep saying it. And television.
We get the odd one coming through now, who've picked it up through the internet, and they come in or they've been on their OE and spent their time in the USA, and because over there country radio is all over the place. You know, there's 2,000 country radio stations, and they come back and they love it. You know, there's. Not everybody's going to love it, but there's going to be a percentage that do, but they just don't get the chance to even hear it. you know. So, so you, I mean, it's a matter of I think things are changing now with the internet, aren't they? And so, so I think on the internet radio, you know, we may have a chance. We might be too old to figure it all out.
It'll just happen when you get your pension, mate.
Yeah. So what I'm trying to do with this all, I'm not trying to be a big star anymore. You know, my time's sort of, I'm cruising through and all that, so having lots of fun. And, but I want to pass on to some of the younger people. So I'm doing this just as a testing of the waters to see if there's
an audience out there.
Yeah, and so that I can, you know, find some young New Zealand talent, and then there's baby steps to get you to a certain point, isn't there?
I've seen a lot of great new talent myself.
They're good. These kids are good.
A lot on the show. Yeah. You've got your Kylies, Kylie Austins, and there's a huge underground thing going on at the moment, bubbling away, and they're all learning, and they're all out there playing acoustic.
Yeah, there's quite a few that have gone across to Australia and doing their thing over there, and there's some that have gone to Nashville, as I did. And, you know, I can't say big enough how much experience you pick up when you go away overseas and you see the competition that's over there, and you have to raise up to it. Otherwise, you know, you go home with your tail tucked between your legs.
I think, you know, us Kiwis, that's that old syndrome of, you know, we're not as good as them. When you get over this, I found that, you know, a lot of them weren't as good as us.
Oh, vocally.
Oh, sure, oh, sure. Oh, no, well,
yeah. No, vocally, sure. Vocally, we're as good as anybody.
Yeah.
It's the presentation on stage, how to present and act and all that stuff. Peter was saying before, that's the experience that you've got to get, you know. Yeah. And so...
they're not getting it here.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, and it's just... places to play.
I've got to mention this song because we're going to play your song just at the moment. The video, this brand new video that's going to be released. When is it being released in Australia?
In about 3 weeks' time.
3 weeks to go?
Yeah.
All right, okay.
Is
there a promotional thing you're going on over there with this?
Yeah. That's all been.
Anything I can do to help. So.
We got a guy named Duncan Toombs who's had 7. Golden Guitar Awards at Tamworth for the best videos over the last few years. He's just amazing. He produced it for me, and he's really good.
It's a beautiful video. I loved it.
They have infrastructure in place where you do the baby steps to do this. So that's what I'm trying to.
There's a whole network there that can help you anyway when you release that song. Yeah. And we're going to play the video. It's a beautiful video. It's called Daddy's Radio, and it has a bit of Rusty, your dad, comes and goes.
Yes, and my little sister Michelle, you can see
Michelle.
Here. Yeah, it's kind of cool.
Okay, here it is, Daddy's Radio, Kevin Greaves.
Oh, Daddy bought it at a neighbor's yard sale. He stuck it in his workshop way up on the shelf. He plugged it into an old brown extension cord. Tuned it into a country station. I'd sit and listen to the songs they were playing while I watched my daddy nailing them to the boards. Music never sounded sweeter than it did coming out of that little blown out speaker. No, I don't mind that hi-fi sound stereo. Between the two, I'd have to choose my daddy's radio. The songs I heard through all that static were hits back then, but now they're classics. So I went out and bought them all on CD. Wouldn't believe how much I paid for that 6-disc changer in my old Chevrolet, but it don't sound near as good to me. Music never sounded sweeter than it did coming out of that little blown out speaker. I don't mind that hi-fi sound stereo. Between the two, I'd have to choose my daddy's radio.
Daddy's Radio, that's great. Beautiful song. beautiful video, and I just got drawn into that. And lovely to see your dad there, you know, Rusty. Of course, the wonderful Rusty Greaves, and he must be—he would be so proud of you, Kevin.
Oh, thank you.
Meanwhile, you two guys now, Peter, Kevin, you are actually doing some gigs together.
It's coming up.
You performed just recently. Yes. You mentioned
at the Churchill Club. Yeah, Churchill. It was the first gig we did together. Actually, we'd been on stage a couple of times at the V's, the Variety Club Awards.
This is just amazing.
So we've got similar backgrounds, and we cleared out. You know, we went overseas, and I really encourage young performers to get themselves a good repertoire together and go. Yeah. You don't just have to be doing. See, if you're a country performer. You need a repertoire that you can, like I ended up in the Canary Islands when I first left Australia, and it's a tourist area, but that's great too because you can get yourself a bar there, just like you did in the old days.
Sort of.
So you'll find yourself a bar and you sit there and you've got people coming in all the time. So if you stayed there for say 6 months with a good repertoire, keep enlarging your repertoire, you can start, you get that together, then you can go out from there. But a lot of them go over there and try and make it, you know, aim for the top all the time.
And they expect to walk on stage and perform like, you know, here it is, and they haven't got the performance skills. That's the problem.
Yeah, but that's what I say, that's where you learn those things.
Now, you guys, we got double power here. You two are out there doing gigs together now.
Yeah, we're doing some stuff together. Yeah, sure. Kevin does comedy too. I do comedy as well. I did quite a bit of comedy in Germany with the British military. When I first went there, I got there in 1990, 6 weeks after the war came down. And there were 60,000 British troops still in Germany after the end of the Cold War. So I worked that circuit for a while doing comedy and music and developed my comedy. I'd done some here before I left, and in Australia. And Kevin's the same. He did a lot of comedy as well. So we work that into our show together. And the one we did at the Churchill Club, we did a lot. We ended up doing a lot of comedy. Not more than we thought we were going to do, but it was great. I mean, the people, because the stuff we do, the people haven't heard before.
I've got to say that Peter Caldon is one of the best exponents of doing a Johnny Cash song I've ever heard. If you ever,
I agree.
And anybody that likes Johnny Cash are going to come along and see him wherever he might be. Does an absolutely amazing job.
We had a lot of young people who were into Cash in Europe. You know, from the new stuff he did when later in his career with Hurt and you know the movie came along.
Wonderful.
They got sometimes we'd get a crowd that was half our crowd. Some in a university town in Germany would be young people under 20 for Johnny Cash.
Okay, guys, we're going to have a little bit of a listen to you guys working together now. And what's the song you're going to do as a duo?
Good Hearted Woman. What else could we do?
We're talking about the
Bordello. Waylon. Give me some Waylon.
It's very suitable. Okay, here they are. Kevin Greaves and Peter Colton together.
Long time forgotten with dreams that just fell by the way.
And the good life he promised ain't much he's living today.
She never complains about the bad times or the bad things he's done.
Lord, she just talks about the good times that we had and all the good times to come.
Cause she's a good-hearted woman in love with a good-timing man. She loves him in spite of his ways that she don't understand. Through teardrops and laughter, we'll pass through this world hand in hand. She's a good-hearted woman, loving her good-timing man. Yeah, he loves the nightlife and bright lights and good time friends.
And when the party's all over, she'll welcome him back home again.
She don't understand him, but she does the best that she can.
Lord, cause she's a good-hearted woman, loving her good diamond man.
She's a good-hearted woman in love with a good-timing man. And she loves him in spite of his ways that she don't understand. Through teardrops and laughter, we'll pass through this world hand in hand. Yeah, a good-hearted woman, love and her good time and man. She's a good-hearted woman, love with a good time and man.
This time.
And she loves him in spite of his wicked ass ways she don't understand. Through teardrops and laughter, we'll pass through this world hand in hand. Good-hearted woman, love in her good time and man. Oh yes, she's a good-hearted woman, love in her good time and man. Yeah.
Good-hearted woman. A man needs one of those, don't they? Yes, don't we all know that? Okay, guys, you're working together. It sounds fantastic. I think you're made for each other, don't you? Get there to get some gigs together.
We'll have a lot of fun.
They're not too far away, I know, but you're off to Nashville, Kevin.
Yes, we've got the gigs. 2 months over there.
But when you get back, you guys are working again in Waipawa and I believe Taupo.
Taupo, yeah.
So watch out for that, folks. Meanwhile, they are going to be both at a big party. I believe you've got a big party coming up, the 50th.
Yeah, my little sister, Michelle.
Michelle, beautiful Michelle. We love you. Michelle Greaves, and she's out there singing and working with Traps with her band.
Midnight Special.
Midnight Special.
Yeah.
It's Sunday afternoon, May the 28th. Yep. We're all going to be there. I believe everyone's invited from the musical fraternity.
Yep.
And that's country music, pop music, all sorts.
Yep.
But we'll all be there to celebrate Michelle, her birthday party. So anyone who's around, Manurewa Koze. I'll say get it wrong. Manurewa Kozi.
Manurewa.
Yeah, Manurewa Kozi. And it's going to be a full house, so just get along there. Party hard. No cover charge that day, is it? It's a party to celebrate Michelle's birthday, her 50th. I didn't realise she was that old.
Yeah, I always thought she was younger than me.
Yeah, so did I. Well, guys, there's the comedy. Look, guys, it's been so fantastic here. I could have sat here for another hour and talking to you. We have so much to talk about.
We'll have to do that some other time.
We might visit the green room and have another glass of wine.
Yeah, we'll do.
Thanks, Shane. Thanks, Kevin. Great to see you.
Thanks, Peter. We'll see you next time. Have a safe journey to Nashville, Pete.
Thank you.
Well, I wish we had another 1 or 2 hours, but we haven't. I just want to thank my guests once again, Peter and Kevin, for joining me here on Rockin' the Planet. I'm Shane. See you same time, same place next week. And until then, just keep on rockin'.